Good afternoon. So this is Janssen Symposium. Over the next hour, Dr. Mohammed Abdelmati, a well-known medical oncologist, malignant hematologist in the NCI, Cairo University, will discuss an important drug, ibrutinib. Ibrutinib is a drug that is FDA approved, and we all know that it's FDA approved in second-line setup in relapsed refractory CLL patients, but the most exciting data is really in its use in the frontline setting, especially in the high-risk patients. So over the next hour, Professor Abdelmati is going to be discussing ibrutinib.
First of all, I would like to thank the Pan Arab meeting for inviting me to give this presentation and thank Janssen. And also, I would like to make me an excuse for my voice because we have a severe cold. I will be discussing the use of ibrutinib as a new way to target B cell malignancies. The process of B-cell signaling and proliferation is characterized by different signaling process, starting from the B-cell receptor pathway on the surface, passing through many signaling steps, especially the phosphatidyl inositol 3 kinase delta and proton kinase receptor, leading at the end into proliferation and survival and maturation and migration of lymphocytes, leading to its development. And any obstacle and any inhibition of this pathway can lead to inhibition of B cell proliferation. What is proton kinase gene? Proton kinase gene belongs to the TEC kinase family. The gene is located on the X chromosome. It is a key B cell receptor signaling molecule which plays a pivotal role in signaling pathway regulating B cell proliferation, maturation, and survival and homing. It is implicated in the pathogenesis of several B cell malignancies, including mantle cell lymphoma, chronic lymphocytic leukemia, von der Strom macroglobulin. When BCR binds to a specific antigen, BTK moves to cell membrane and it is phosphorylated or activated by cyclin tyrosine 551, which requires a molecule of ATP able to bind to it. Second phosphorylation at tyrosine 223, then the BTK gene is now active. Clear target for inhibition. If the ATP cannot bind to the BTK molecule, phosphorylation cannot occur and the enzyme cannot be activated and the B cell proliferation stops. Who gets the name of ibrutinib, how it comes? We can divide it into I, which indicated in the modern technology a breakthrough, a game changing product like iPhone, iPad. Derived from the name of the target molecule, BCR. Imatinib is proton tyrosine kinase inhibitor. Tinib, as we all know, is by convention, all tyrosine kinase inhibitors end by the suffix tinib. Why ibrutinib is a breakthrough drug? It is the first in-class covalent BTK inhibitor to reach advanced clinical development, and it reached phase 3 trials ongoing across different B-cell malignancies like CLL, mantle cell lymphoma, and von der Strom macroglobulinemia. It has an impressive objective response rate shown in clinical trials plus favorable safety profile. Granted breakthrough designation by FDA, chemotherapy, as we will see in CLL or small lymphocytic lymphoma, and refractory relapsed mantle cell lymphoma and von der Strom macroglobulin. How ibrutinib acts? It is a potent, highly selective oral small molecule covalent BTK inhibitor. It binds specific amino acid cysteine 481 in BTK active site. It is highly specific covalent bond. It blocks the ATP binding to the protein kinase, tyrosine kinase. It produces a stable, sustained inhibition of BTK enzyme activity. And the most important, it is not cytotoxic to T cell or natural killer cells, leading to the lower answers of immunoinhibition of T cells and natural killer cells. Also, ibrutinib act on B cell apoptosis and proliferation. It induces apoptosis in CLL cells greater than normal B cells, which is very important. It inhibits the process of downstream of BCR that sensitizes cells to apoptosis. It also inhibits activation-induced proliferation of CLL cells in vitro, plus it significantly inhibits CLL cell DNA sense. Also, it has an important impact on other B-cell malignancies. For example, in diffuse large cell lymphoma, it showed a selective toxicity towards diffuse large B-cell cells with chronic BCR signaling, and it is tested in many ongoing trials and facilitating the kill of active B-cells with the use of chemotherapy. Also, in many trials, evaluating its effect in myeloma, it acts through phosphorylation of BTK and downstream signaling osteoclast, diminishing bone resorption, cytosine chemokine secretion from osteoclast and stromal cells. Also, it induces CXCL12, induced multiple myeloma cell migration, and malignant inhibit multiple myeloma cell growth. And the most important is it inhibits bone resorption by multiple myeloma cells. Before discussing the results of ibrutinib, we have to realize that there is many characteristic clinical observation in patients with CLL treated with BCR inhibitor, especially ibrutinib. First of all is treatment response and efficacy. Second is treatment-induced lymphocytosis. Third is tolerability and adverse effects. First of all, ibrutinib produced a dramatic efficacy with high overall response rate to single-agent ibrutinib. Deep remission is infrequent. Rapid improvement in lymphadenopathy, cytopenias, and disease symptoms. It is effective also in high-risk patients, including patients with deletion 17B. It has a durable response with continued treatment despite the presence of residual disease. We can realize that many patients is not in CR, but they are having a minimal residual disease negativity. However, it should be given as a continuous therapy until the appearance of toxicity or intolerability or progression. Maximal response is often, we have to realize that maximal response is often slowly growing over time, and timing of assessment of response is very important. We cannot assess the response after, for example, 2 or 3 months. We have to wait. And the effect of surrogate endpoints such as partial response, CR, and minimal residual disease should be reassessed. And of course, the continuous therapies make serious issues regarding the cost and accessibility of these drugs in many countries. Also, resistant or disease progression after ibrutinib is related to genomic instability of CLL clone. And there are 2 major patterns of relapse. Either it may be early progression, mainly attributable to Richter transformation, which is rare after ibrutinib, or late progression, mainly attributable to CLL relapse as a result of acquisition of resistant mutation. And there is many several mutations documented for ibrutinib, like the case of imatinib. Although imatinib and adalimumab are much superior to any other treatment option, it appears that deletion 17B and 11Q still have a negative effect on outcome with ibrutinib treatment. And 11Q and deletion 17B may retain their prognostic role even in the era of signaling kinase inhibitor. So some selected patients with deletion 17B may still benefit from allotransplantation even in the novel agent era. And there was a study in the last ASH discussing the fate of patients after discontinuation of first kinase inhibitor therapy. Most often, kinase inhibitors are discontinued due to toxicity or cellular progression, 80%, not due to terrestrial transformation. Subsequent use of an alternative kinase inhibitor following first one discontinuation can be clinically effectuous, and as expected, more durable response is achieved by patients who discontinued kinase inhibitors to toxicity versus patients who discontinued kinase inhibitors to, due to disease progression. And the most important finding, which was found in almost one-third of patients, is what's called treatment-related lymphocytosis, and it was recently designated as partial response with lymphocytosis. It occurs in one-third of patients. It is due to migration of CLL cells from tissue compartment into the blood, causing paradoxical, transient, and benign lymphocytosis that must be distinguished from disease progression. It presents the persistence of quiescent clone and does not predict, which is the first, most important, a subgroup of patients likely to relapse early. In the majority of patients treated with ibrutinib, lymphocytosis resolved within 8 months. In a subgroup of patients, lymphocytosis lasts for more than 1 year. And in one study, prolonged lymphocytosis may be associated with a favorable outcome. A need to, for a different approach with these patients, and the effect of response assessment including MRD should be reassessed. A recent revised response criteria was proposed, allowing a new response category called BR with lymphocytosis, which is a clinical response reduction of lymph nodes, myomegaly, with persistent lymphocytosis in the absence of other indicators of progressive disease. Ibrutinib has a very favorable tolerability compared with chemoimmunotherapy, as it is orally bioavailable. Most common adverse effect occurring in more than 10% of patients is limited immunosuppression, with grade 3 or more neutropenia in 16%, thrombocytopenia in 11%, anemia in only 10%. GI toxicity is also common, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, decreased appetite, and abdominal pain. And the most common general effect or side effects of ibrutinib is fatigue, musculoskeletal pain, peripheral edema, and bruising and rash. And the rate of reduction infection is higher in relapsed refractory patients, and it appears it may be primarily due to underlying disease, not the drug itself. Also, bleeding effects are very common with ibrutinib. It occurs in all its grade in about 40 to 50% of patients, mostly in form of petechiae or ecchymosis. However, grade 3 or more bleeding occurs in only 6% of patients, and we should be cautious in using antiplatelet or anticoagulant in such patients, and we should hold the drug before invasive procedure by 3 days and after by 1 day. Also, atrial fibrillation occurs in 6 to 9% of patients and is a new onset in less than 3%. And it is very recently potentially thought to due to inhibition of cardiac phosphatidylinositidyl kinase AKT signaling, and it is particularly common in patients with cardiac risk factors, acute infections, and previous history of atrial fibrillation. Also, we have to realize that ibrutinib is primarily metabolized by cytochrome B450 enzyme 3A, and we have to avoid concomitant administration of ibrutinib with strong inhibitor of this enzyme because it increases ibrutinib toxicity, for example, ketoconazole, itraconazole, and all the azole groups. And also, of course, the grapefruit. The patient should not receive grapefruit juice 3 hours before and 3 hours after ibrutinib. We have to be cautious in using strong CYP3A inducer because it decreases ibrutinib plasma concentration and may lower the response, most commonly with carbamazepine, rifampicine, and phenytoin. Let's discuss the results of ibrutinib in different disease. For relapsed refractory CLL, we have two very famous studies, either using ibrutinib as a single agent or in combination. The first is single-agent brotenib in relapsed refractory CLL, which is called the RESONATE study. It has 391 patients. 127 of them have a deletion 17B, and it randomized patients to receive imatinib versus ofatumumab, and imatinib significantly improved overall response rate, having 42% versus 4% with ofatumumab, and this is highly significant. The median progression-free survival was not reached with ibrutinib versus 8 months with ofatumumab. The overall survival 90% versus 81%, which is significant also, and it reduced the risk of death by almost 60% reduction. And benefit of ibrutinib in high-risk patients was documented in the form of better overall response rate, median progression-free survival, overall survival in patients with deletion 17B. The second study, which is using ibrutinib in combination with endomustine rituximab, or BR, in combination in more than 570 patients, all of them none of them is having deletion 17. The overall response rate is much was better with ibrutinib single agent by addition of ibrutinib to BR, 82% versus 67%. Also, the median progression survival was higher, and the ibrutinib lead to reduction of risk of death by 37% when compared with BR regimen without addition of ibrutinib. Also, the benefit of ibrutinib in high-risk patients was documented to have better progression-free survival in bulk patients with bulky disease, unmutated IGFVH, and a high number of rare cerebrates and deletion 11Q, as we can realize that there is no patient with deletion 17B in this study. Also, testing ibrutinib of monotherapy for relapsed refractory 17B CLL patient only, which is discussed in the last ASH, is in a study called RESONATE 17, meaning deletion 17. In those patients, very high-risk patients, deletion 17B, relapsed refractory, we have obtained an overall response rate of 82%, 1 year of progression-free survival of 80%, results of compares favorably in historical comparison, even with that upfront treatment of deletion 17B CLL with FCR, which is the most commonly used drug in CLL, with a median progression survival of less than 1 year. However, complete response rate were rare in this such patient, 5%, and we have to thought on doing some form of consolidation of those patients in the form of allogeneic stem cell transplantation if possible. The second indication is imatinib in newly diagnosed elderly patients with CLL. As we all know, treatment of treatment naive elderly CLL is very difficult. Chlorambucil is relatively well tolerated, but outcomes are very limited. Chlorambucil and fludarabine are equivalent, but fludarabine is more toxic, which is in CLL5 study. Rituximab or obinutuzumab with chlorambucil is better than chlorambucil alone, but more toxic, which is in CLL11 study. Ofatumumab and chlorambucil is better than chlorambucil, but more toxic, which is in complement 1 study. And we will discuss with each other which imatinib, ibrutinib, the two famous ibrutinib study, the phase 1-2 study, BCYC 1102, and the RESONATE study in elderly CLL. The first trial in first line therapy of ibrutinib, which was phase 1-2 dose finding and toxicity finding study in CLL small lymphocytic lymphoma. It tests 132 CLL patients, 31 treatment naive, and almost 100 relapsed refractory patients with a median age of 68 years. 27% of patients has deletion 17, and 27% has deletion 11Q. We have an overall response rate is of about 78% for all treated patients, which is a figure not preceded in any previous study. 83 in treatment naive patients, 76 in relapsed refractory patients, and 55.9% for relapsed refractory patients with deletion 17B, which is the highest risk of CLL. This was followed by the RESONATE study. The RESONATE study randomized oral ibrutinib 420 milligram once daily to the standard drug at that time, which was oral chlorambucil, in treating naive CLL requiring therapy in elderly patients above 65 years of age. And this study, ibrutinib was superior to chlorambucil in elderly patients regarding overall response rate, 86% versus 35% with chlorambucil. Response were independent of the presence of high-risk features like deletion 17. Also, ibrutinib is superior to chlorambucil regarding median progression-free survival, which was not reached with ibrutinib versus almost 19 months with chlorambucil, and the difference was significantly in according to independent assessment and or investigator assessment in both assessment of, done in this study. The risk of progression of death was 84% lower with ibrutinib than with chlorambucil. Regarding overall survival in the RESONATE study in elderly patients with ibrutinib, ibrutinib is superior to chlorambucil regarding 2 years overall survival, making a survival of 98% versus 85%, and the relative risk of death was 84% lower in the ibrutinib group than in the chlorambucil group. And the effect of ibrutinib on overall survival was robust and observed similarly across all subgroups examined according to the age, deletion 17B, gender, race, and geographic region. And we can do an indirect naive comparison of progression-free survival for RESONATE 2 study versus elder treatment regimen known. We can realize the ibrutinib lead to the highest progression-free survival ever known, followed by chlorambucil obinutumab, followed by chlorambucil ofatumumab, followed by single agent chlorambucil. And we can realize that in these two studies, ibrutinib lead to very high overall survival in the first study, BCYC 1102, and also in the RESONATE study, much, much higher than the overall survival in patients treated with chlorambucil alone. And the survival is almost comparable with healthy patients with aging at 72 years old. So, ibrutinib was introduced in the guidelines of NC guidelines in the recent revision in 2016 in relapsed refractory CLL, either in as elderly or young patient, in patient without deletion 17B as category 1, and it's more preferred than the chemoimmunotherapy. Also, in patients with deletion 17B as category 1. And in first-line therapy, it is only used in these guidelines in CLL patients with deletion 17, and it's also preferred than chemoimmunotherapy, and is also category 2B. What about ibrutinib in patients with relapsed refractory mantle cell lymphoma? In a recent study in the year 2013, published by Wang in New England Journal of Medicine, it is an international phase 2 trial of 111 heavily pretreated mantle cell lymphoma with a median treatment of two or three lines before ibrutinib, describe greater efficacy and excellent tolerability. With a median age of 68%, 68 years, we have an overall response of 68% with a 21% complete remission rate, and a median time of response of almost 2 months, and response rate appeared to increase with longer duration of survey. Median duration of response is 17.5 months, and median progression-free survival is about 14 months. And there is no difference in progression-free survival and overall survival according to whether it received previous bortezomib or not. The same. And so, ibrutinib was put in the NC guidelines, the risk guidelines, as a second line therapy in transplant candidate patient followed by autologous cell transplantation and on non transplant candidate patient also in all ages group. The last indication and the most. The most impressive one is the use in the rare indolent lymphoma subtype, von der Sturm microglobulinemia. As we can know, MYD88 mutation is highly prevalent in von der Sturm myeloma, von der Sturm microglobulinemia. And in this mutation was found to trigger the tumor cell growth through BTK, which is the target of ibrutinib. So the target of ibrutinib, we can use ibrutinib in this such type of lymphoma. A multi-center single-arm trial of 63 patients, previously treated patients, was published in September 2015 by Trion. Ibrutinib was used in CLL as CLL 420 milligrams daily until disease progression or unacceptable toxicity. And we have an overall response rate of 62%. Of course, complete response is not encountered as in all types of von der Sturm microglobulinemia. But we have a very good partial response, 11%, and very good partial response, 11%, and partial response in almost half of patients. Response rate was highest with MYD88 mutated patient and CXCR4 wild type. Patient, as is found that 6R type mutation produced resistant to ibrutinib therapy, and if it is wild, it have an overall response of 100%. And median time of response is only 1.2 months. And in this study in von der Sturm microglobulinemia, we have a 2 years progression-free survival of almost 70% and 2 years overall survival of about 95%. And this is a summary of FDA approval for ibrutinib therapy. Ibrutinib was approved for CLL in February 2014 for treatment of CLL in patients who received at least one prior therapy, and July, let's say 5 months later, for treatment of CLL, any patient with treatment with deletion 17B, either as a first line or second line. Also, it was approved for mantle cell lymphoma in November 2013 for treatment of patients with mantle cell lymphoma who have received at least one previous therapy. And most recently, ibrutinib in January 2015 was approved for treatment of von der Sturm microglobulinemia. Ibrutinib is available as capsule 140 milligrams. The dosage of CLL and von der Sturm microglobulinemia is 420 milligrams daily, taken together, three capsules together, oral daily. The dosage of mantle cell lymphoma 540 milligrams, four capsules oral daily. It should be given at approximately the same time of the day, and in pharmacokinetic studies, administration with food increased ibrutinib exposure approximately twofold compared with administration of other overnight fasting, and it should be briefly given an empty stomach, and should be, of course, as said before, continuously used until disease progression or unacceptable toxicity. In summary, ibrutinib is the first BCR signaling pathway inhibitor. It acts by competitive BTK inhibition by inhibiting the binding of ATB to the BTK enzyme, BTK signaling pathway. It was a breakthrough drug in the management of different B-cell malignancies. It is indicated in CLL, either relapsed refractory or inhibition of deletion 17, and in relapsed refractory mantle cell lymphoma and patients with von der Sturm microglobulinemia. It is orally bioavailable. It is highly effective with favorable tolerability and limited toxicity, and we should know it causes in one set of patients a transient treatment associated lymphocytosis in many patients. Thank you. I'm ready for questions.
Thank you very much, Professor Abdulmohty, for this excellent presentation. And now we have a very good time for question.
Can I ask you the first question before people come up with questions? Lymphocytosis, as you said, is very common when you give ibrutinib in the first 8 months. And we know that with idelalisib, when you give rituximab with idelalisib, you are decreasing the lymphocytosis. You're not seeing it anymore. And the Helios study, you've shown it looks to be less lymphocytosis and maybe more beneficial. Do you see that ibrutinib is going to be given in the near future with rituximab?
There is very small studies adding rituximab to ibrutinib, and the results still now are very similar in both studies. Your point is correct. The lymphocytosis was very reduced, very less marked with rituximab, but the response in very small studies was similar, and there is a very large randomized study comparing ibrutinib versus rituximab and vinblastine. It's still accruing patients, no results yet. I think the future will the addition of ibrutinib to the newer anti-CD20 antibodies.
Yes.
I have a comment on this point that will be presented in my talk next session. That is a malignant clone of CLL is usually protected in the lymph node by its microenvironment due to cell-to-cell interaction and chemokine and continuous B cell receptor activation. So when we give idelalisib and ibrutinib both, they will disrupt this mechanism, leading to transfer of cells from the its sanctuary in the lymph node to the peripheral blood. So in the peripheral blood, there will be initial lymphocytosis. When the patient is exposed then to rituximab in a combination, this cell in the peripheral blood is in circulating in a resting state. So the rate of lymphocytosis will decrease gradually, although it is persistent in some conditions and not interfere with response.
Any other question?
So thank you, Professor Abdulmohty. This was an exciting symposium. And